Hello, everyone, and thanks for joining today's edition of the EV Journal Club. Today, we have a guest from Chicago, Edward Campbell, who's at the Loyola University Chicago. And Edward is going to be sharing with us some data from a recent publication in JEV and also some exciting new results from his lab. So Ed is somebody with whom I share a lot of common interests. We both study HIV, and Ed is also interested in neurodegenerative diseases. And so I'm very much looking forward to hearing about his recent work today. And I was just talking with Ed right before the Journal Club started, and something very interesting project that he's had going recently is to help with COVID-19 SARS-CoV-2 screening for a local school district. So you know, Ed and many of us are trying to wear multiple hats these days during the COVID-19 pandemic. And so I would again like to welcome you, Ed, to the EV Journal Club. Thanks for presenting today. And I will turn the screen sharing over to you.
Great. Thanks a lot, Ken. I just say thank you very much for the invitation. And as Ken said, I've been a little bit distracted with, I guess, things that are normally not in my purview. And I'm really excited today to talk a little bit about the basic science that my lab does that normally is what occupies me on a regular basis. So also, as Ken said, my background is really not one that was always fully steeped in the study of extracellular vesicles. And I'm going to take a few slides to kind of explain, I guess, what brought me to this area. So I guess in my previous studies as a postdoc and as a PhD student, for years we've been using quantitative, multiplexed, if you will, fluorescent analysis to understand the HIV life cycle. And a key tool that I developed in those studies is going to come up a lot today, so I just want to take a brief moment to explain it. So in our studies of HIV, we have the ability to fluorescently label viral cores and monitor their behavior inside of cells. And for years, a real problem that we had was that cells will, generally speaking, eat things that land on them, including viruses, through endocytic pathways. And of course, we're interested as virologists much more on post-fusion events where the viral core is released into the cytoplasm through a fusion event. And we really lacked the ability to discriminate between these two populations of viruses in cells. And this was a thorn in our side for many years. And so a solution to this problem that we came up with a number of years ago was to utilize a fluorescent membrane-associated fluorescent protein that we call S15 GFP or S15 cherry. And what this protein has is the first 15 amino acids of SARC and aristylation sequences in there, so it associates with membranes. And we found that this gets, generally speaking, very efficiently incorporated into viral particles. And in our HIV studies, what this would allow us to do is discriminate between those viruses that were in the endocytic or vesicular compartment that for us we don't really care about most of the time, from those viruses that have lost this S15 membrane label through a fusion event and then are simply positive for, say, a GFP marker that we use to follow the core. And here's an example of, you know, when we first characterized this system, what we would do is we would spin these viruses down onto cover slips, and I'll explain that in a moment, and stain them for markers like VPR, which is one of those fluorescent core labels that I just told you about, or a viral protein like capsid, P24. And you can see here that either version of this S15 leader sequence allows for the incorporation of this membrane marker into viruses. And I won't go too much into this. I actually talked about it the last time I spoke with the John Hopkins folks, I think about a year ago. But we've used that in a number of publications now to discriminate between fused and unfused virus populations in cells. And here in this paper, what we did was we identified a microtubule adapter protein called BICD2 is responsible for mediating the trafficking of the core, the HIV core in the cytoplasm. And what you can see here is we see a real loss of motility if we focus our analysis on the S15 negative population, whereas the unfused virions don't seem to be affected by the knockdown of this factor. And this makes for a very nice internal control in our HIV experiments. But the other thing that we noticed, or I noticed for years, as I was doing studies like this, is that depending on the labeling efficiency that we had or how well we were making virus, there would frequently be a number of S15 positive puncta in our images that were not positive for either P24 or VPR. And at the time, honestly, my thinking at the time was, oh, these are those exosomes people are talking about. I don't really care about those. And obviously, the story today will be about how I came to care about those. So to kind of twist the analogy a little bit, this kind of started out as being one man's trash, but it actually ended up being kind of the same man's treasure in the story that I'll tell you about today. And so another trick from the virology world that I just want to introduce is one of the ways that we bind cells or viruses to cover slips. And this is through a process called spinoculation. And a number of years ago now, I guess about 20 years ago, there was a study from the Malam lab where they showed that you could really increase infectivity of viruses on cells with a relatively low speed spin, 1200 G for 2 hours. And we've used this also for years to synchronize HIV infection when we want to image the subsequent events during infection to kind of create a nice starting point of all of our viruses, because we do this at 17 degrees or 4 degrees and you don't get fusion or endocytosis at those temperatures. And also, this is really, I think, the impetus for some of the studies I told you about, because this is also how we characterize batches of our HIV-1 viruses. So making viruses that are efficiently labeled with S15 is obviously critical to all those studies that I showed you before. And I've probably spun more batches of virus down onto cover slips to see what kind of labeling we had in a viral prep more than I've done almost anything in my life, because we really need to get a really high degree of labeling with S15 to make that membrane marker work in our experiments. And so when we became interested in extracellular vesicles, we started using this S15 marker now in the absence of any viral proteins or viral production to see if we could label extracellular vesicles and to see if we could start to use the same kind of fluorescent imaging-based approaches that we use in our HIV studies to characterize populations of extracellular vesicles. And so here, this will start to get into the paper that we recently published in JEV. And so, you know, the first thing we did was we purified EVs through differential ultracentrifugation. And we did a Western blot that showed, as you might expect, if we detergent solubilize these EV populations, we lose our S15M cherry signal, as we do most of the other tetraspanins. But that these EVs are positive for this cherry marker, as you might expect. We did a little bit of EM. This certainly isn't our area of expertise, to show that the EVs that we were producing from this ultracentrifugation had some canonical markers like tetraspanin, CD63, and CD81 by ImmunoGold. And what I've done here is just shown one of like the first pictures that we took of these EV populations on cover slips. And so what we do in this case is we fix these EVs down onto cover slips, and we also stain them using indirect immunofluorescence for, generally speaking, markers of interest. We're going to use a lot of markers of interest in the tetraspanin family today. Obviously, these are canonical EV markers. And we also, because of some stories that I'll tell you towards the end of the talk today, we also use LAMP1, which is a lysosomal-associated membrane protein, because we're very interested in secretory pathways that go through the lysosome. And we observe that it quite a good number of extracellular vesicles that end up on our cover slips are positive for this LAMP1 marker. And so here's a representative picture of what we would see in a field. But really then what we took to doing is a kind of semi-automated analysis method that we use for our virus studies all the time. And this really revolves around an imaging package or a software analysis package, Ameris from Bitplane. And what we can do is we can create algorithms that reliably identify individual puncta in a field. And then once this algorithm creates surface masks around a specific fluorescent channel of interest, we can then interrogate the surface masks that have been created in this regard around one channel in a multiplexed way and analyzing the presence or absence of another EV marker, if you will, in these individual surface masks created around the first channel. And so what we can do by imaging, you know, hundreds or thousands of extracellular vesicles is we can start to characterize them in a two-dimensional way, utilizing other markers that we stain for, whether it be a tetraspanin or a LAMP protein that I showed you before. And here's an example where if we just add the secondary antibodies and omit the primary antibodies in such an analysis, you can see that the vast majority, or you know, 98% of these EVs come in as, and we can use this to define what negative for either of these channels is. And so then when we introduce primary antibodies to LAMP or any of the tetraspanins, we can essentially start to generate data that starts to look more like flow cytometry plots with pretty high ends, and start to characterize these EV populations for the presence or absence of these individual markers. And what we noticed right away is that even though there was slight differences in the levels of tetraspanin staining that we were seeing, what was very nice is since we included LAMP1 in all these stains, what you can see here is that if you consider both, you know, quadrants here in this quadrant analysis, we see about 20% of these EVs being positive for LAMP in this counter stain with CD9, but we see very similar numbers across different examinations of different tetraspanins, telling us that we're seeing a pretty reproducible level of LAMP1 marker in these EV populations. And this got us very excited, and we started to push the system a little bit to ask, you know, the questions that we, you know, addressed in our JEV paper of just how quantitative can this approach be in characterizing extracellular vesicle populations using an approach like this. And so what Kevin Burbidge in my lab did was really, since there was really no roadmap for this, we started analyzing these data in every which way we could. We could either analyze individual images and count them as individual ends, or we could take all of the images that we take and pool them together and characterize the degree to which individual EV populations were positive for markers like CD9 and LAMP1, or really any tetraspanin. And what you can see here, and here's the negative control that shows again what I showed you before, if we don't include primary antibodies in our stains, you know, virtually, but never quite perfect, kind of like flow cytometry, we see that the vast, vast majority of EVs don't end up being positive for any of these markers. But when we start to stain for things like CD9 or LAMP1, we can start to see that really, regardless of how we analyze these data, we get very reproducible measurements of what fraction of a population is either positive for CD81, for example, or both markers, regardless of how we analyzed the images. And this made us feel, obviously, pretty confident moving forward that we could use this to characterize extracellular vesicle populations. We also want frequently to look at EV populations that might be present in small amounts, or we do some iPSC cultures that are pretty expensive where we can't grow up larger volumes of super cells to allow for the large amount of supernatant that sometimes one wants to collect EVs. So we also just started to ask, well, do we need to concentrate these EVs through differential ultracentrifugation in this approach? And what we see is we see a modest difference in some cases between the tetraspan and the amount of EVs or the percentage of them that are positive for individual markers. But by and large, what we saw was that the populations of extracellular vesicles and probably in the unconcentrated case, some small amount of cell debris that aren't really the exosomes we've loved or the extracellular vesicles we would prefer to interrogate. But what we observed is that we didn't see a very significant difference in the concentrated versus just directly spinoculating these EVs from supernatants. And so we also did some characterization of the spinoculation protocol that I mentioned to you in the previous slide with really a number of questions. So number one, if we're spinning down EVs from a supernatant or a concentrated EV population that we've purified through centrifugation, what fraction of the EVs actually end up hitting the cover slip when we do this? And then the second question would be, if there's a little bit left in that supernatant that didn't hit the EV, that didn't hit the cover slip, are we biasing ourselves towards a certain EV population that does or does not hit that cover slip? And what you can see here is, and we used uncoated cover slips or polyl-lysine cover slips. Polyl-lysine does help the EVs stick down a little bit. But what we observed is that if we do a primary spinoculation, you can see that, and we count the number of S15 puncta that are on the cover slip, we invariably see about 10 to 20% of those, that same number of EVs are present if we take that same supernatant and spinoculate that again onto a new cover slip. And so that gave us the opportunity to ask, well, is this population of EVs any different than this population of EVs? Because that would give you pause and wonder about the bias that this approach might give. But in fact, what we saw was that if the first primary spinoculation was analyzed in the same way that I just showed you and compared to the secondary one, there's really no difference between the EV population that hits the cover slip after the first spinoculation when compared to the second spinoculation when analyzed in this way. The second thing that we ended up doing, and actually we had strong reservations about even saying that this would be a quantitative approach, but the reviewers graciously prompted us to start to ask some of those questions. And so what we observe is that we can actually look at the number of EVs that hit the cover slip in this way and found that it's a reasonably quantitative method to calculate the number of EVs, either specific for a individual marker, in this case like S15, or we've done similar experiments now with PKH labeled extracellular vesicles. And we observe that as we dilute the virus, we do see a nice trend downward, as you might expect, that looks reasonably reproducible. It's not a flatly linear curve, and I certainly wouldn't want to be in a head-to-head matchup with an approach like a nanosite technology. But generally speaking, the amount of EVs that hit the cover slip are reflective of the concentration of EVs in our samples. And so with this in hand, what we wanted to start asking was, well, are all EVs the same? Or are there different populations of EVs that we can use this approach to characterize? And the first thing we did was a reasonably simple experiment where we just took extracellular vesicles produced either from 293Ts or THP1 cells, which is a monocytic cell line that we use a lot in our lab as it effectively can model macrophages or microglia in our HIV studies, as well as our neurodegenerative studies. And what we immediately saw was that, you know, depending on the marker that we examine, extracellular vesicles from different cell populations, whether it's 293Ts or THP1s, here's again the negative controls. But what you can see here is depending on the marker that we look at, there are pretty notable differences in the fraction of S15 EVs that are either positive for LAMP1 or individual tetraspanin markers. Here's a CD9, CD63, and CD81. And we haven't really looked at any functional relevance of these differences yet, but you can see them quantitated over here, where we were very interested to see that THP1 cells typically released extracellular vesicles that were more likely to be positive for LAMP1 than 293Ts. This is, again, very interesting to us because this is microglia or macrophages, you know, tend to have a pretty active secretory pathway that I'll talk about in a few slides that seems to be a form of secretory autophagy. And in comparing these cells, you can see that a much larger fraction of extracellular vesicles from THP1 cells are positive for LAMP. And we also see, again, differences in the tetraspanin content of these S15 positive EVs released from these two different cell types. So, okay, this represents now differences in EV populations that are released from two different cell types with really the same cargo marker that we've been using since the beginning, this S15 marker. Well, what about different EV cargos? Do we see differences in cargos? And to ask this question, what we did was we took a few representative proteins that, number one, was convenient because we happen to have them in the fridge because we have almost every HIV protein tagged to something fluorescent. But these particular proteins, and I won't go too far down into the details of this in my talk today, but all three of these HIV proteins, TAT, VPR, and NEF, have all been implicated as being cargos of potentially pathological extracellular vesicles containing HIV proteins. This is actually thought to be particularly important in neurocognitive issues associated with that is frequently seen in HIV-infected patients. In these HIV-infected patients, they're usually on, or almost always on, antiretroviral therapy, which stops viral replication. But you can still get, in some infected cells, the production of some HIV proteins. And it's in the context of these HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders or HAND, these particular cargos have been implicated as being some of those proteins that are loaded into these extracellular vesicles and have the ability to potentiate neurological issues in patients. And so, again, we kind of we made now surfaces around these individual GFP proteins. Before, we were basically creating that first mask around S15, but now we can create that first mask around TAT-GFP or GFP-VPR or NEF-GFP and ask those same types of questions. You know, are they positive for individual tetraspanins or LAMP markers? Or we also looked at the escort protein TSG101 because obviously it has a role in the normal biogenesis of extracellular vesicles through the exosomal pathway. And I won't go into all of these individual differences, but, you know, generally speaking, things that popped out is NEF-GFP, which is thought to, it associates with the plasma membrane in almost the identical way as the S15 membrane marker that I showed you before. There we see a very low level of LAMP in these extracellular vesicles, consistent with some sort of either plasma membrane or a secretory pathway that maybe doesn't include the lysosome, where other proteins that maybe are thought to kind of cause membrane perturbations or disrupt membrane homeostasis, such as TAT or VPR, we see a larger fraction of those are positive for this lamp marker. And again, to start to get at that lysosomal secretory pathway that I'm hinting at, so I have to be sure to get there, we also started to look at differences perhaps that might occur in the glycan content of these EVs. And the reason we did this is through this secretory pathway, it's known that differences in the ability of lysosomes to degrade the cargo can either trigger the release of proteins from this pathway, and even in some cases in neurodegenerative diseases, the ability to degrade some of these glycoproteins or glycolipids in the lysosomal environment is thought to be very relevant to the disease state. And so what we did is now we came back to our S15M cherry label, and now instead of staining with an antibody, what we did was we stained with a number of different lectins that are specific for the different kind of glycan branches that can exist on glycoproteins and glycolipids. And I won't take you too far down this rabbit hole, because unless you're a glycobiologist, you won't like it. I do tend to like it. But the take-home message from this is that when we disrupt lysosomal degradation using an acidification inhibitor like bafflomycin A, we see that some of these glycans, as reflected by the ability of lectins to bind them, the presence of some glycans on these extracellular vesicles change. And we were very interested in actually using these glycan markers as potential EV markers in the absence of this S15 cherry signal at this point in time. And so these differences, you know, we're still looking into in some work that we're doing with the Michael J. Fox Foundation to understand if these, you know, differences in glycan signatures can be used as potential biomarkers in the context of extracellular vesicles containing alpha-synuclein. But while we were playing with this lectin labeling system, we also started using another fluorescent dye, one of these PKH dyes that many of you are probably familiar with. And we found that these dyes were also really nice in their ability to identify individual extracellular vesicles in the same types of assays that I showed you before. If we make surface masks around the PKH dye signal, again, just like we were doing for S15 cherry in the beginning, and start to make the same kind of plots, what you can see is here's our negative control again, where you can see really no signal associated with either stain CD81 or LAMP1. But when we start staining with antibodies to those specific proteins, we can create the same kind of data now using this PKH membrane dye as a fluorescent marker for that first mask. And then we wanted to control for this and ask, you know, well, what fraction of the PKH dye dots are we, like if we're looking at our S15 marker, because obviously, and I can tell you that not every extracellular vesicle that we look at in a cell that's produced with this S15 membrane marker, it was a kind of a crutch to get us going. We see that a fraction of those EVs end up being positive or negative for S15. It ends up usually being about a 50-50 mix. But the most importantly is we know for sure that the S15 membrane protein, because it has a myristoylation sequence, is associated with a lipid bilayer or a membrane, meaning that we're probably looking at a vesicle. And very nicely, what we saw was that in this case, the vast majority, nearly 100% of the S15 cherry spots that we would see in an experiment like this would be positive for the membrane dye PKH. And that told us that we're really efficiently labeling those extracellular vesicles, well, things that are extracellular vesicles because they have a membrane, because we know that that's where this S15 cherry protein should reside, and we're seeing virtually all of those labeled with the PKH dye. And this allowed us to ask, to move perhaps away from these basic science experimental systems and start to ask things about primary samples, because now if we can use this PKH dye as opposed to something like S15M cherry, which obviously needs to be exogenously expressed in a experimental setting. But by using this PKH dye, what we can start to do is characterize EV populations from primary samples, such as plasma and saliva. And this, I had no idea how important this would be, but actually Barack Balva, one of the people that was doing this work with our primary samples, including saliva, and is now actually working in the pop-up lab that Ken mentioned in the beginning, where we take saliva and instead of staining it for extracellular vesicles, we look for COVID RNA. But again, what you can see is that we can label, and I think we have plasma here. I don't think I have the slide for saliva. There's modest differences that we observe. But really in both cases, we were able to label extracellular vesicles with this PKH dye or this lectin WGA, which is a very broadly specific lectin that allows us to also see extracellular vesicles by virtue of staining those glycoproteins and glycolipids on the EVs. And in each case, what we can see is we can do the same type of analysis, either using this PKH dye as that first gate in that multiplexed analysis, or a WGA stain to really do the same thing, and then characterize them again, in this case, for those tetraspanin markers, or CD63 in this case, or LAMP1. And so I would say that this kind of encapsulates the paper that was just in the Journal of Extracellular Vesicles. And so I'll briefly summarize, I think the key points that I just showed you before I pivot into some other work that we're doing. But in general, this EVMAC, as we've coined it, this extracellular vesicle multiplexed analysis of colocalization is what I think it means. But generally speaking, whatever you want to call it, it can allow for the quantitative characterization of extracellular vesicle populations. And the cell type specific and cargo specific differences that we observe, even with our very generic, if you will, or canonical EV markers, what could be used in other studies to look at potentially pathological markers of pathological extracellular vesicles in the disease state. They could either be used as biomarkers for pathological EVs in biological samples, or back in the world that I live in most often, we think it's likely that the markers that are present on some of those EVs are going to be reflective of the pathway that they use during their secretion. And that can tell us a lot about the cell biology going on in those cells and potentially give us insights into disease mechanisms, which we're very interested in. And so if there's any questions about this part of the talk, I'm happy to kind of stop and take some questions now.
Great, okay. Well, before we go on to the next part then, I see we do have a question in the comment box, and we might have some more too that come in. But the question here is from Lucia. Lucia, go ahead. Actually, can you unmute yourself? There we go. Let's try it again. Sorry about that.
No problem. Okay, perfect. Thank you, Dan. Yes. Oh, excellent. A very nice set of data. It was at the very beginning when you showed the SARC is the 15 amino acid that you use for SARC. I was wondering if that construct will be forced into caveolae rather than, do you have any bias because the SARC sequence has a specific localization?
Right. Well, the sequence there, the 15 amino acids, really does just tend to concentrate it in the lipid microdomains that we would all call lipid rafts, if we believe like in lipid rafts and can call them that. It tends to go to cholesterol-rich regions of the plasma membrane. We have never noticed a bias towards, caveolin or anything like that. But honestly, we've been really looking at the protein that comes out. And probably to do those studies, you'd probably kind of want to do something a little bit differently on the way in. But certainly when we image these cells, for example, expressing this protein, we always see to some degree their accumulation in what's clearly some intracellular vesicles.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you.
any other questions? I think that I have a couple myself. So, you know, there have been some reports of the PKH dyes and other lipid dyes forming self-aggregates. And we see this too, but variably, you know, depending on the buffer, and we don't know what else, honestly. So, yeah. So do you see this this phenomenon, or do you think it's a problem?
Well, so I definitely think it's a problem. We see it, but I think you can work around it. So, I mean, certainly what we had to do, and I think there's a ratio or a sweet spot of a certain amount of dye that you add to a certain number of EVs. We can really bring this down. And I think we hit that sweet spot in some of our experiments, because obviously then we wouldn't have seen, some of the data that we saw. But even of all the PKH positive EVs that we observed, do we know that like every one of those is not perhaps one of these spontaneously forming micelles? No, and that is to some degree, I think, a weakness of that labeling method. I think we can get around that sometimes by, you know, if we're interested in another marker, but certainly puncta in this type of assay that are simply PKH positive, we'd be, I think we did the best we could, but we see similar things.
So in other words, you are seeing that it really depends on how much of this stuff you're adding. And so it might be that the appropriate control would not necessarily be to just put the same amount of PKH dye into buffer, but rather, you know, we're really talking about the free dye that's still around.
Yeah, absolutely. No, when we did that control as well, that is kind of an epic disaster, because if you don't give the dye the real membranes to intercalate into, well, then you definitely get all of these spontaneous micelles. And if you kind of titrate it down with the amount of EVs, you can see that generally speaking, I think goes away. So I think the presence of EVs and that ratio of dye to EVs is what we found to kind of be the really important factor.
Interesting. Good. Okay. All right. We have a question from Corey. Corey, go ahead with this related question here.
Thank you. Yeah, I was just curious if you could clarify real quick what you're saying in terms of how you were setting up those ratios. Are you normalizing to, you're saying a number of EVs. How are you quantifying that number of EVs so you can get your ratio correct?
So whenever I show the number, we're basically counting the number of puncta that hit the cover slip, which again, I showed that figure where it was reasonably quantitative, although not perfectly linear. Right, but we tend to use that number as basically the number of dots that we see can often be informative to some degree, as much as the amount of colocalization with other markers we see.
Gotcha, awesome. Have you ever validated that with like a nanosite to show that they're pretty much the same? I'm sorry, I missed the front end of the talk, so I'm sorry if you already talked about that.
Yeah, I don't think we published that. You know, I would say that, like, you know, you see a dilutional trend in both systems, right? And certainly I think a nanosite gives you a nicer linear curve than our approach, that's for sure.
Thank you so much for clarifying. Appreciate it.
Great. Okay. Well, it looks like we don't have more questions in the comment box right now. So I'm actually really excited to see this next part too. So, So let's go ahead with the second part of the talk.
Sure. And, you know, for the sake of time, I'm kind of going to briefly introduce some topics that are much deeper than this. And if there's aficionados in the room, I apologize. But so in general, we're really interested in the propagation of the protein alpha-synuclein in the context of Parkinson's disease. And there's a number of different models and other studies that have shown that pathological misfolded alpha-synuclein can move from cell to cell in a way that leads to the propagation of the disease phenotype. And I think the best evidence of this was really from some studies they did in patients that received dopaminergic neuron transplants with the idea, and so in Parkinson's disease, it's a loss of dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra that lead to the dysfunction and loss of motor symptoms. And in this study, the basic idea was, okay, your neurons are old and dying, but here are some embryonic ones, and hopefully these will graft and form the right connections. and lead to an alleviation of symptoms. And maybe for some of those patients it did, but then by and large, most of those patients lost any benefit of the transplant. And while they were alive, the people doing this study, including Jeff Cordova, who's a friend of mine, was like, oh, the neurons must not, the graft must not have taken, they must not have formed the connections that we were hoping. But as these patients started to pass away, what they did was they were able to look at these brain sections, and what they observed was now alpha-synuclein pathology that you would normally only ever see in a 50, 60, 70, or 80-year-old brain was now present in this tissue that they had transferred 4, 6, or 8 years ago, suggesting that this pathological material had been transferred from the environment where the neurons were older into these younger neurons. And so when we first got into this field, what we were very interested in was these questions that were framed by a very nice review by Jennifer Steiner and Patrick Brunden. And we focused in on this question, which I need to explain the answer to understand our current studies, which is when alpha-synuclein is essentially getting into or invading a new cell, how does it leave the endosome to access the cytosol? And we started to attack this question, again, using a common theme as I kind of use the tools that I learn about in virology and try to spread them out into other areas. And an imaging-based trick that we used was to use proteins called galectins, which are, they have a very high affinity for these glycans that are normally only on the outer leaflet of a plasma membrane and therefore on the luminal side of an endocytic vesicle. And if you express these galectins in cells, what happens if a vesicle is damaged by an invading virus or a pathogen, or as I'm about to show you, an amyloid protein? Now these galectins can get access to these glycans and they form a microscopic puncta, or punctum in the singular. And we're not very good at everything, but obviously we like to measure puncta. And so in the first set of experiments we did, which was quite some time ago now, we took some fluorescently labeled alpha-synuclein and put it on some cherry Gal-3 expressing cells. And what you could see is that we could frequently observe these alpha-synuclein aggregates or fibrils co-localizing with cherry galectin-3, suggesting that following endocytosis, they had damaged these vesicles. And in the course of these studies, where we're interested in the consequences of synuclein following endocytosis on the cell, we started to observe a series of things that honestly is what spurned a lot of my interest in extracellular vesicles. And here's an example of a couple of the things that we would see. And so here what you can see is in a cell expressing cherry galectin 3, which we've treated with synuclein fibrils, we sometimes see these rather larger than normal extracellular vesicles that apparently have been secreted into the extracellular space. And these extracellular vesicles are positive for both the cherry galectin 3 marker and those synuclein aggregates that we've added to the cells. But we know for sure that these have been in and then out of a cell because we only see this channel light up if we don't have cherry galectin 3 expressed in our cells. And so another example would be from a movie like this. So these are iPSC-derived dopaminergic neurons that we've treated that are, number one, expressing this cherry galectin 3 fusion that we've again treated with recombinant alpha-synuclein fibrils that have been fluorescently labeled. And if you watch this movie, you'll see what appears to be a vesicle kind of come to the top of that cell soma. And then if you wait for it, it appears to get transferred in the context of a galectin-positive vesicle. And, this was rather shocking to us, seeing these kinds of transfers are not easy to do. And so I showed this to a few friends, and they got very excited. And that really got me down the rabbit hole of how extracellular vesicles have been implicated in PD pathogenesis. And a number of studies have collectively shown that pathological synuclein is much more effective at entering a cell and causing pathology when it's in the context of an extracellular vesicle. And the other thing that kind of came up in more recent years because when I showed my friend Jeff Cord over this movie, he was like, oh, well, you know, I don't think anyone's ever seen that before. And at the time, kind of like a dope, I was like, oh, well, that's probably because I'm really good at imaging. Maybe I'm so, you know, smart or something like that. But the answer is actually a little bit more embarrassing, because as it turns out, these galectin proteins actually play a functional biological role in some of these processes, as opposed to just being a marker for extracellular vesicles that Darwin gave us. And there's been a couple of studies that, including these, but a number of more recently, that have shown that these galectin proteins can, number one, recognize these damaged vesicles and direct them into a compartment for autophagic degradation, but also that there's a secretory pathway that is kind of an alternative to autophagic degradation, which is generally being now described as secretory autophagy. And essentially what these studies showed is that this secretory pathway is to some degree galectin dependent. And that's also the crux of some of the data that I've really focused on the extracellular vesicle side of the story for you today, but we see the same thing. So when we were seeing these movies of the transfer of synuclein, you know, maybe we're not bad with a microscope, but essentially by overexpressing galectin 3, we're probably increasing the rate of secretion via this particular pathway, which allowed us to see some of the things we did. And so what we wanted to do next is to ask questions about, well, if extracellular synuclein comes into a cell, damages a vesicle, and ends up in the autophagic compartment, there's also a lot of data that shows that alpha-synuclein that's normally expressed in a cell is degraded in some way by the lysosome. There's papers out there suggesting that chaperone-mediated autophagy or macroautophagy is the primary degradative mechanism of its synuclein expressed in a cell. And then we thought, well, if this misfolded extracellular synuclein is ever in the same vesicular environment with endogenous synuclein, that might be really important to the idea of how how synuclein propagates in a prion-like fashion. And so to start to ask this question, we developed a way to basically differentiate the extracellular synuclein fibrils we're seeing from synuclein that's present or that's expressed in the cells to which we add the extracellular synuclein. And the way we went about doing that is we utilized a fusion protein that's basically a bifurcated complementable system that involves both GFP and luciferase, because we wanted to focus our analysis on non-monomeric forms of synuclein, which are thought to some degree beyond the pathological pathway, although I realize if there's synuclein aficionados in the room that this is a wild oversimplification. But in general, what we can do is we can express two forms of synuclein in a cell that when they oligomerize, give us both GFP and luciferase signal. And so then the questions that, the experimental paradigm that we set up was we would take alpha-synuclein fibrils or not and add them to our cell lines expressing these dual split protein alpha-synucleins to see, do we see these forms of synuclein in the same place at the same time? What's the impact of synuclein fibrils on the release of endogenous protein and other questions related to maybe the underlying biology of this. And so first, if synuclein fibrils cause lysosomal damage, and lysosomal damage is known to sometimes increase the expression of synuclein in a cell, do these exogenous fibrils increase the rate at which endogenous synuclein is getting released? And the answer is perhaps modestly, but yes. So if we add synuclein fibrils and then measure the amount of luciferase signal associated with our alpha-synuclein protein in the supernatant, we see that this goes up. And then we wanted to ask questions of, are these alpha-synuclein fibrils interacting with this endogenously expressed form of synuclein? And so what we did here was we did the same kind of EVMAC analysis that I've showed you before, but now we're going to be gating our analysis on those those puncta on our cover slip that are the GFP signal coming from that endogenously expressed synuclein. And what you can see here is there's at least a number of instances where the exogenous alpha-synuclein fibrils that we've treated end up in extracellular vesicles that are positive for both our endogenous alpha-synuclein and also galectin-3, which we can now stain for with an antibody, not using anymore this the fluorescent version. And we can start to get a sense of the degree of co-localization of these two synuclein components and galectin-3 in the overall population of endogenously expressed synuclein that's released from cells. And so here what you can see is a control. If we don't treat with alpha-synuclein fibrils, and all of these circles have kind of been adjusted to reflect the fraction of the total population that we see co-localizing. But obviously here in the negative control, we see very little. But you can see even under these untreated conditions, a notable fraction, around 30% of them, we see as positive for galectin-3. And we see something very similar that I don't have time to maybe walk everyone through with galectin-8. When we start to add these alpha-synuclein fibrils, now we can see co-localization of both the endogenous and exogenous protein. But now we start to see that about two-thirds of that is now actually positive for this galectin-3 marker. So basically creating, you know, a model where the exogenous fibrils come in, create damage to the lysosomal compartment, and perhaps by this damage, they are increasing the amount of these vesicles that end up getting secreted. Essentially, the way we view it is relatively simple, perhaps in advance of the model I'm about to show you, which maybe isn't. But in general, what we think is happening is that these exogenous fibrils are damaging the lysosomal degradative capacity of a cell. And when autophagy then recognizes these damaged vesicles, by kind of inhibiting that degradative pathway, what's going on is that the secretory pathway associated with the autophagic pathway is being increased. And so to hopefully in a limited way show you that, you know, here's the model figure from the paper that we're about to submit, and I apologize for not going into all of the autophagic details here today. But essentially, we see synuclein fibrils come in. We think they damage vesicles. And these damaged vesicles, through interactions with proteins like TRIM16 and ULK1, recruit the autophagic machinery. And then this autophagic machinery, especially when degradation is inhibited, leads to the secretion of these damaged vesicles, which can now contain the original inoculating exogenous synuclein, the synuclein that's been expressed in this cell, and then its release can go on and create further pathology. And then in this way, what we think is this might explain, if you will, the synuclein life cycle in the context of its prion-like behavior. We don't really know what starts it, but once you have exogenous synuclein fibrils flowing around in the CNS, the same pathology that causes lysosomal stress, or the same way they cause stress in cells, is also then what triggers the release of more synuclein from those same cells. And so that's really all I have for you today. I really appreciate your attention. I've highlighted the people over on the left that have done the majority of the work. Kevin Burbage was really responsible for many of those experiments in the JEV paper I talked about. Ben and Grace and Jenna were master's students in the lab that contributed to individual figures, and Dave Rademacher did a lot of the EM I showed you. These are our collaborators on the Parkinson's side, and these are the people that supported some of the work. So with that, I appreciate very much your attention, and I'm happy to take another round of questions.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Ed. I really am glad to see these data as well. And it looks like Fabrice has a question here for you. about the alpha-synucleins. Fabrice, go ahead.
Yep. Thanks for the very nice presentation. So yes, yeah, so I was wondering if you can measure with your fluorescence technique if alpha-synuclein locates at the surface of EVs or inside or both, because there is a couple of reports that show that the alpha-synuclein can be bound on the outer leaflet of the EVs and maybe potentially impact on, you know, T cell reaction and also like endocytosis.
Right. So we definitely, I don't think we could measure that utilizing kind of the wide field fluorescent deconvolution that we do. It's plausible that some like super resolution imaging technique might be able to address that question. But I also think too, you know, in a lot of work that I didn't show you, looking at different fibrils of different neurodegenerative diseases, we think that might almost be an academic question, because what these things, the easiest way to think about these things in the context of, you know, endocytic and lysosomal degradation is it's basically like swallowing a nail. And the nail punctures or can, you know, damage that membrane. And at that point, it's kind of on the inside and the outside at the same time, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Lucia?
I have a question. Can I go, Ken?
Please.
Sure. Okay, hi. This molecule is fascinating, and I may have missed it. I'm sorry if you did. Which family does alpha-synuclein belong to? I'm looking for a counterpart in other cells of this pathway.
So I would say the synuclein family, there's like three or four synucleins. I think there's like a beta and a gamma synuclein that don't get a lot of attention. But you know what synuclein is thought to do in its native state, right, is to facilitate synaptic vesicle fusion in neurons to facilitate neurotransmitter release and things like that. And it has a certain ability to bend membranes in a way that facilitates that. Now, when it goes bad, if you will, then the conformation of the pathological synuclein is significantly different than what it normally does in a cell. And no one knows really what triggers that. But then you have more of like a beta sheet style assembly that is not only pretty consistent with different types of synuclein fibrils, and there's many types. My friend Ronald Melke in Paris, he's made like all kinds of different depraved versions of these different synuclein strains, and he tends to name them after pasta because he's a French person who loves food. But these are really all the same, fundamentally similar to things like tau and Huntington that form these kind of amyloid assemblies. And in that way, once it starts to misfold, it's more in these amyloid proteins where it shows homology too in terms of the structure compared to structural similarities to other things like synucleins.
Yeah, because we're new at this area of the synaptic. We're just starting, and the NOGO family, N-O-G-O, is what we're looking at right now in vesicles, but I don't think this is a member of the NOGO family.
I don't think so, no.
Okay, thank you.
We have a question from Bob, Robert Gilman. Localization.
Yeah, we've been doing work with vesicles in the brain. Can you localize this stuff using immunohistochemistry in brain tissue?
Well, I think the really hard part. There would be two really hard parts that you would need to get over to accomplish that. Right. Number one is when you stain tissue like that, and especially on the fluorescent side where we kind of live, maybe in immunohistochemistry you might have some advantages, but tissue, especially CNS tissue, there's always some amount of autofluorescent puncta that I think would make your life miserable. The other thing that I think would be very hard is identifying a vesicle that's in the extracellular space as opposed to being inside of a cell, right? And we actually think that, you know, the data I showed you in our kind of view is that, you know, the only difference between that vesicle is where it is. Sometimes it's inside of a cell, and then sometimes a cell just kind of barfs it out when it can't digest it. Proving that there would be it's an EV and not an IV, if you will, or an intracellular vesicle would be something that I think is going to be really challenging. And I don't think that our approach would be really great for that. I think you'd almost have to be doing EM to identify the interior or the extracellular membrane to definitively say that a given vesicle is inside or outside of the cell.
Thank you.
And one last question from Corey.
I was just curious if you had done any work to look at whether this process that you're describing with the pathologic fibrillized ASIN causing the damage and causing secretion is happening in both glial cells and neuronal cells. Do you think it's mostly happening in the phagocytes? What do you, or have you looked at cell specifics?
Right. So, so we've looked at a microglial cell line, again, THP1s, if you differentiate them, some people will let you call them microglia and other people won't. We haven't done too much work with primary microglia. We've done more work with, say, iPSC-derived neurons or neuronal cell lines. And at least on the way in, we see a pretty similar result, which is, they're generally endocytosed. They cause this kind of vesicular damage. And that's a common feature. Downstream of that, I think there's probably differences that, there's certainly inflammatory pathways that are present in a microglial or a monocytic type of cell line where this causes the activation of something called the inflammasome much more effectively in a microglial cell compared to a neuron. And I think the secretory pathway is probably a little bit more turned on in a microglial cell or a monocytic cell compared to a neuron. But these are things that we're just kind of starting to think about now.
Really, really cool questions. Is there a reason why you've kind of been limited in terms of being able to use primary cells versus the differentiated iPSCs or the cell lines?
Right. We've done some experiments with primary mouse microglia. I think it's such a pain to get those. And we almost had an avenue to get primary human microglia, but then, that's kind of dependent on, a lot of things that you might imagine to get those kind of cadaver samples. There's a company that I know that sells that those kinds of cells, but the price is really high. So the question is, is there that much of a difference between the cell line and the primary cells? But usually it's cost and ease of experimentation, to be honest and fair with you, that has made us use the cell line models.
Gotcha. Thanks so much.
All right. Well, that brings us to the end of the hour. I think we're a few minutes over, but thanks to everyone for your participation and your questions, and special thanks to Ed for joining us today and sharing the work and even some bonus slides. So thank you all. I hope you all have a great rest of the week, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Bye now.
All right. Thanks a lot.